Ciao di uno, alcun periglio il credi correr non puoi, pensi lo corri è grave, se fai col tuo diverti, fai vuol soverchi ogni ragione in lui.
Sì.
Scordarmi come giunto arriva il naufrago nottiere, i flutti obblia. Ogni tempesta mia in te s'acqueta, e vien da te mia stesso ricordo tuo, quel che t'amò cotanto, quel che alla mare t'insegnò primiero, e non t'abborra il re. Dimmi pria, ti vedrò, prometti, giura.
No, mai più.
Mai più, mai più. Sia questa la risposta al tuo giurare.
Ognuno è ognun tremante tradimento. Già si è smerto, noi mi metto.
Uccedetemi, se io vengo, uccedetemi, se io vengo, nudo i nervi a po' fra il petto.
Così è smerto,
noi vengo, noi vengo.
Al monire,
uccello,
e vivo, al mio sguardo appena il del suore. Forse han tratti
tutti
tempendo e giungi la tua discolpa.
Live from Lincoln Center, this has been Act One of Gaetano Donizetti's Anna Bolena. Our six principals in this first act were Dame Joan Sutherland as Anne Boleyn, Judith Forrest as Jane Seymour, Jerry Hadley as Lord Richard Percy, Gregory Urisich as King Henry VIII, Cynthia Clary as Smeaton, the Queen's page, and Jan Opelok as Lord Rochefort, Anna's brother. The New York City Opera Orchestra is conducted by Richard Bonning here in New York City's Avery Fisher Hall. This opera in concert presentation, the first such in our Live from Lincoln Center series. This opera is one of a trilogy that Donizetti composed based on historical English subjects. And the story of Anne Boleyn, King Henry VIII, and Jane Seymour is one of the most human and personal in all history, and I might add, in all opera. Dame Joan Sutherland, Jerry Hadley, Richard Bonning, Jan Opelok, And on the other side of the stage, Judith Forst, Gregory Urisich, and Cynthia Clary. Anna Bolena, in its time, was the first popular success that Donizetti achieved. And then the opera fell into neglect for nearly a century. It was revived in the 1950s and also has figured in the repertory of the New York City Opera. And let's go backstage to our host, Robert Jacobson.
The great prima donnas of the early 19th century who sang roles such as Anna Bolena started not as sopranos, but as mezzos. Dame Joan Sutherland, too, began as a mezzo. When I met with her at the Knickerbocker in Chicago a few days ago, I asked her if she continues this tradition.
By extension. And I know that you did begin as a mezzo-soprano, and your mother was a fabulous mezzo from everything I can tell. Do you see yourself as having built the voice in similar fashion?
I don't really think that it was built that much. I think that the voice was always there. I think the actual physical equipment, the vocal cords, were capable of doing that. I didn't think they were, and because my mother was a mezzo-soprano, and because we had all that music in the house, and because she was terrified, I think, of doing any damage to the voice, because she did perceive that there was something a bit sort of special maybe there. She didn't want to extend the voice and do any damage before a certain age. She said that I shouldn't really work on the voice before I was 18, and I think she was right, because I think the proof of her guidance is there insofar as it's been a long time since I made my debut.
I think it was also, granted the fact that Joan has a big voice, it was very wise and very fortunate that she began as a mezzo-soprano, because she started singing with the voice centered low. And I think this is very important when you are singing the bel canto repertoire, because if you have a voice which is centered high and is lighter, you can't produce the emotion that is required for this hefty role.
You started out with basically a core of a voice. And you went from there, but you had to be convinced.
Oh, well, Richard had to convince me. I mean, the only way he convinced me was the fact that I have what's... Well, I don't have perfect pitch. I have relative pitch. And he would make me get away from the piano and really tricked me into accepting that I could sing the higher register notes, that I could sing in a higher tessitura. I had been working up to it by singing, I guess, some of the Handel pieces had taken the voice into a tessitura that sat high, and some of the Mozart sits in a high area. But I never really essayed to sing the straight-out so-called coloratura roles. I didn't think of myself singing sort of high E's and F's, although I actually have sung an F sharp, haven't I?
In public?
Never in public. Well, she's sung high F's in public many times, but the F sharp she's talking about, she was very much a private affair. She got in a very wild rage with me one day, because she was quite sure that I was ruining her voice by putting it up there, and she shrieked an F sharp to prove that she couldn't. Only she could.
So that was the end of me.
You know, we throw around this term bel canto, and we've been doing it for decades and decades, and essentially it means beautiful singing. But don't
That's what it is.
But don't you feel, though, that it means having at your command, at your disposal, everything imaginable and everything possible in the vocal artillery?
Yes, it does. You know,
and in a way, you've worked. I mean, you've spent a lifetime developing that artillery, so to speak, so that it's all possible.
But you know, the older I become, the more I think that bel canto is not only beautiful singing. I think that's the basis of bel canto. But I think a singer that shows that all they think about is beautiful singing brings about the death of bel canto, because all the bel canto, the bel canto has to be very dramatic and has to be very alive. And this is more than singing vocalese.
So it's phrasing.
It's creating living characters. living characters who sing gloriously. That's Bill Cantor.
But don't you think it comes through phrasing and coloration
it's
and all, dramatic
all,
effects?
All part of it, all part of it, and a supreme technique, which should never be... The public shouldn't be aware of a singer placing notes or showing how difficult a thing is. In fact, it should seem fairly easy.
Yeah.
In fact, a lot of people say when Jones sings that it looks so easy. Well, it's not. But that's the trick.
That's the mirage.
To make it seem easy. It should seem easy.
Well, it's interesting. On a recent documentary about Sir Laurence Olivier, he said that acting is technique, and that technique should be the prime consideration of any actor because it then gives that actor versatility.
This is true, but the technique must not be shown to the public.
Yes.
And I'm sure he didn't let the technique show.
No, but he was accused by the critics of letting that technique show and come across as his first consideration. That was one of the things that critics had him for.
I think in his great roles, he didn't show the technique.
And sometimes I think that in some of your critiques, they've said, well, you know, she's a technical marvel, but, and then there were all the yes buts, and maybe there are not enough words, there's not enough theater, or whatever, in past times.
Well,
no, but maybe at times she did show the technique too much. But the technique must be there.
But in a way, that's the beginning of it all, because you can't go out on raw emotion and perform basic...
Absolutely not.
It's the public that have to feel the emotion.
The public must be absolutely destroyed by emotion, but not the singer on stage, because how can they possibly control all the time? Because singing is control, very much. They have to control the throat, they have to control the diaphragm, they have to control the breath. They must only control and control the mind. And if you have to control your own mind in order to control the public's mind.
Well, that's why I guess we've seen a number of people fall by the wayside, and the fact that the whole battery of things hasn't been in order, and you have kept yours in order. Not only in order, but I just think it gets better and better.
I wouldn't say that it's always in order. I mean, some nights one is capable of doing much more than one is on others, and it has always been thus. No matter how technically proficient you may be, you will always have nights when it just clicks that much more than others. And sometimes they're not the nights when you think it's clicking that much more than others either.
Well, just because Richard...
So you just don't know.
Richard said because you don't hear yourself. And
that's
in a way,
right.
you can be giving a completely different performance than you're hearing in your head.
Yes, you can feel when everything gels the way you want it to. And it's not very often.
Dame Joan, it's no secret that you've been singing in the public eye since the early 1950s. How do you account for these many, many wonderful years on the stage and also maintaining such a high level along the way?
I think I've been fairly disciplined. I've set myself certain restrictions. We never sort of traveled backwards and forwards on a jet from one place to another too fast. I mean, if you had a concert tour, you had a concert tour, and you did the rounds. But if I've been recording, I've mostly just been recording. I haven't been singing an opera, say, in London at the same time. I have colleagues who come to recording sessions flying in from other cities, and I find I never could do it. I became disoriented. I wasn't quite sure where I was, and I wasn't quite sure what opera I was singing, and one had a sort of a detached feeling up there, and I didn't like it, so I never really tried to do more than one thing on the whole at a time. I have done recording while I have been singing at Covent Garden, but I have stayed in London all the time, and I think it paid off.
So
I think the jet has a lot to answer for.
She also sang in the right repertoire
for
most of her life. I think that's very important, that because, you know, singing Donizetti and Rossini and Bellini, it's like medicine for the voice all the time.
And it's kept the voice high, basically high in placement and healthy.
On the contrary, it's kept the middle in good
order. Middle, okay.
And it's the middle of the voice which is the most important part of the voice.
If the middle of your
voice is in good order, you'll be able to do whatever your voice is capable of, which is sing high notes or low notes. But if your middle is not in good order, then you can forget the rest.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what so many young singers today, I hear them before performances, they are screaming and practicing their high notes all night in the dressing room.
If you have a good technique, the high notes will be there. You have to have faith in that they will be there. If you've got the middle under control, then the bottom and the top should follow.
Yes.
I don't go too much towards the bottom, but one does hear them trying out their high notes all the time. And if I did that, I would feel as though I'd have nothing left by the end of the performance.
It becomes kind of a preoccupation.
It's a certain nervosity. It's a certain.
People are worried
sort of
they won't be there.
But either they're there or they're not. It's the old story of Björling saying, you know, that he didn't warm up, that if he was well, he didn't need to, and if he wasn't well, it wasn't going to do any good anyway. So, I'm a bit like that myself. I do a few phrases, but no excessive warming up at all. I sing the sort of roles that give me plenty of exercise on the voice anyway.
Dame Joan, what in the whole bel canto artillery, what was the hardest thing for you to master? What gave you the most problems? Was it learning how to trill or?
Oh, no, trill was always there. Mm-hmm. I never really had to learn how to trill.
What didn't come naturally?
Legato.
I suppose a legato line in the upper register.
No, in the middle register.
You mean in knitting a whole series of notes together in a very meaningful phrase?
Well, I mean, it, to a certain extent, but my mother had always said that you had to, although that there might be a middle and an upper and a lower register, they all had to be joined together without any bumps or seams showing. And I tried it, and I thought I was doing quite well, but he tells me that it was...
No, it's a
pretty
matter of
rocky.
Fact,
a little lumpy.
I think it's very interesting when one looks back. I think she used to sing with a very and rather unlegato, rather Germanic style in the beginning, and in looking for this wonderful legato line, I think that was the cause of all the
mushy diction,
which we got hold over the coals for.
So you can never win, right?
So you can't win.
I think in the last sort of 10 years we've managed to balance it out much more.
But they still talk about mushy diction.
But it's you know that all these are problems. Singers are always going to find problems, and the problems don't go away even when you become very, very famous.
Well, it's very difficult to enunciate in the high areas of the voice. You cannot
also,
without
yeah.
either making a bump or if you don't enunciate, you might get a better legato line. But it's very, very difficult.
But spinning out a seamless line and getting every consonant is a difficult
combination. Well, we try for perfection, but you know, it's
never quite there.
But certain vowels make more beautiful sounds. And, I mean, the A in, speaking in English, the A and the O vowels make the most beautiful sounds. The E and I vowels tend to be
squeezed.
Harder and not so round. And Garcia, in his treatise, says you should sing all cadential passages, all runs of any description, no matter what word you're singing, on the A vowel.
A vowel, yes.
But you do that today, then you're criticised for having bad diction. So where are you?
Do you sing vocalises?
Do you sing bel canto, or do you? To be quite honest, one has to make compromise. Modern taste.
As the years go on with such spectacular singing, does it get easier or harder?
I think from the learning point of view, because one doesn't learn as fast, and I never did learn that fast anyway, it becomes harder. But I think from the performing point of view, one's much more relaxed about it. One isn't so tense. One feels that you can only accomplish so much. And although the audience, I think, expects a little more than they should, I think one has become a little bit too much of a good thing. But one doesn't worry about the performance as much, and I think that helps too, because it gives you a much better basis on which to get out there and do it.
You know, I look at your face and I see these wonderful high cheekbones and these obviously these great resonating cavities. Have you ever always felt that your physique and everything was made for singing?
I think so. I think it's a hand-me-down from my mother and the Scots ancestry to a certain extent. Even some of my nieces and nephews have similar features, and I think it has got a great deal to do with it. I think there is a great resonating cavity
chamber
there. Well, I think there is, and
what else is important? Is the high palate important?
No, this is definitely. I have got a very high palate.
Mm-hmm.
And
what about
a big mouth?
Big mouth.
Oh, definitely the I have a marvelous chest cavity as well, too.
And the diaphragm for
good,
support?
Good diaphragmatic support, and there we are. Don't let's get on to singing to you.
No. You know, it seems that from what you've said and what I've read, that you started out with a tremendous gift of nature, and that was what you had in the two little
chords. Oh, it was there.
Chords.
It was there.
But that everything else took tremendous application and tremendous diligence, and that you really didn't take anything for granted, or maybe you couldn't take anything for granted.
Well, I certainly wasn't allowed to take anything for granted once I met and married him. There was no sort of backsliding permitted.
I mean, he kept the standard up.
Oh, yes, yes.
And, you know, I think with singers, they're in the unfortunate position of not being able to hear themselves as the public hears them. I mean, no singer hears what they do.
This
I mean,
is true.
Today they tend to trust a little bit to tape recorders and things like that, but even that gives them a very false impression of what they sound like, and it gives them a false impression very often of the size of their voice.
Yes.
You know, and I think every singer needs somebody to just listen, because faults creep in all the time. It doesn't matter who the singer is. I mean, there's no singer in this world is or ever has been perfect. In fact, it's very amusing when young singers come along and sing to one for auditions. You know, you frequently can spot exactly who they've been copying, whose records, because they not only copy the virtues, they copy all the faults as well.
So you've been, among other things, a monitor along
the... Very definitely.
In hearing what's happening with the voice. And have you been able to see a great deal of change in Dame Joan's voice over these years?
Oh, I think it's become much, much warmer, much more thicker and bigger voice as she got older. And I think the voice contains much more emotion now than it used to. I find it's a more interesting voice, because it has many more facets now.
Maybe it's because we just think it can't go on forever, so we can try a few more desperate things.
What drives you on? Just the fact that people keep offering interesting projects?
Oh, and also perhaps the idea that one might get bored. I don't know. I don't see how I could vaguely get bored, because I have several interests, and I would like to have the feeling that I could pursue those without worrying about whether I caught a cold.
Do you both feel a little bit of weight of responsibility at this point in time? I mean, in a way, you've created your own era. The post-Maria Callas period has certainly been the era of Joan Sutherland and the Donizetti, Bellini, Rossini repertory. And in some ways, the bel canto revival wanes and ebbs and comes and goes. But you are kind of the Parnassus of bel canto at this point, and you've created a heritage. Have you felt your position in history at all?
I think the responsibility rests with people having paid out a heck of a lot of money to travel. Sometimes they travel from the other side of the United States or something and come to a performance, and they have not that much that they're paying for tickets out and fares out of their own income. I think the responsibility is to the public. I don't think either Richard or I have ever thought of ourselves as educators at all. I think people come to be entertained.
More entertainers.
And exactly.
We don't like ourselves if they don't like us.
We hope that they enjoy the performance that they've paid for, and that's the responsibility.
You seem very focused on what you want and what you're after, and you go and do it.
Well, we're both
very lucky to have been able to do it.
And we're both very stubborn.
Yes. What about that stubbornness when it comes to working together?
Oh, well, someone has to give in, it's usually me.
This program is made possible by a grant from Exxon. Exxon, quality you can count on in the performing arts. This program is also made possible by grants from the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, the Robert Wood Johnson Jr. Charitable Trust, the National Endowment for the Arts, and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
Listen. There's something in the air. It is music and dance and comedy and tragedy. It is the 12th exciting season of great performances on your public television station. It is Ubin Mehta conducting the New York Philharmonic, the sparkling innovations of the American Ballet Theater, the splendor of opera with Pavarotti and Domingo, and drama at its richest, from Virginia Woolf's To the Lighthouse to the hilarious You Can't Take It With You. And it is the grace of Baryshnikov and Tharp, the magic of Lena Horne, the whimsy of Alice in Wonderland. It is Great Performances, television's longest-running celebration of the lively arts and the artists and performers who make our world a richer place. You won't want to miss a single evening in the exciting 12th season of Great Performances, shown each Friday on your public television station, brought to you in part by Exxon.
Live from Lincoln Center, coming to you from the stage of Avery Fisher Hall in New York Performing Arts. And we're presenting in concert the opera Anna Bolena by Gaetano Donizetti. The only new character whom we meet in the second act is Sir Harvey, the King's officer, who will be sung by tenor Gran Wilson. Richard Bonning conducts the New York City Opera Orchestra, Act Two of Donizetti's Anna Bolena.
Ancella bella al suo cospetto.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.